Hello, and welcome to Get Yourself Published, Promote Your Research, a webinar series from the Himmelfarb Library Scholarly Communications Committee at the George Washington University. In this eight-part series, we explore tools, resources, and tips that can help you get your research published and ensure that it's widely read and cited. Our brief videos cover topics ranging from spotting a predatory publisher to using covenant software for a systematic review. Our webinars are publicly available under a CC BY NCSA Creative Commons license, although some resources discussed in this series are only available to faculty, staff, and students with access to Himmelfarb Library resources. My name is Sara Hoover, and I'm currently the Metadata and Scholarly Publishing Librarian at the Himmelfarb Library. This webinar was created in collaboration with Ann Linton, the Director of the Himmelfarb Library. Today's session is called Copyright for Authors, and in this session our goal is to explore some of the most common copyright issues experienced by authors. Please note that this session is meant to provide guidance on resolving basic copyright questions. The content in this session does not constitute legal advice and is not intended to replace the advice of legal counsel. On that note, let's get started. Today I want us to start by imagining that your research is complete. It's now time to write up your findings and get them published. In a previous session, we talked about tools you can utilize in order to find a journal for your research. Today, we'll explore whether there are rights-related questions that you should consider when publishing and distributing your research. In this session, we'll cover the following topics. We'll give a brief overview of copyright and why it's important for helping to protect your rights as a researcher. We'll also explore copyright questions that you should consider when compiling your research for publication. Lastly, we'll also examine your rights as an author, explore strategies for negotiating with publishers, and assess situations related to sharing your research and data. Today I'm joined by Peter, a resident with questions about copyright in his research. Peter, thank you for joining me.
I've heard a lot about copyright, and most of it seems pretty boring and complicated. Why does it matter for my research?
Great question, Peter. Basically, it's important to remember that copyright is designed to protect your intellectual property. In most cases, staking claim to your work is important for professional advancement. Copyright helps to ensure that you get credit for the work that you have done and for your expertise in a given area.
Oh, that's helpful to know. What does copyright protect?
That's another good question. Copy refers to, quote, original works of authorship fixed in any tangible medium of expression, and covers the expression of an idea. Basically, what this means is that copyright doesn't necessarily apply to ideas or facts, but copyright does apply to how you state facts and ideas. In scientific research, one area where this is very important is data. Copyright law does not apply to data, facts, or ideas, but it may protect a collection of data as part of a database or other compilation. We'll talk about this more later on.
Oh, that sounds important. What do I need to do to apply for copyright?
In the United States, copyright is actually presumed. In other words, you don't necessarily need to apply for copyright to be protected.
I'm so happy to hear that I don't necessarily have to register for copyright to hold the rights to my work.
Actually, it's a bit more complicated. Just because you created a work, it doesn't necessarily mean that you're the copyright holder.
What? Who else could possibly be the rights holder if it's my publication?
There are a few scenarios where you would be the rights holder for your data or your publication, but in many cases the publisher holds the rights to your publication. And if you're working for hire for a university or company, that institution has the rights to any data that you might have collected. Also, in some cases, the rights holder is the U.S. government, or items are in the public domain if they were created in 1923 or earlier.
I can't believe I'm not the rights holder for my own publication. If the publisher is the copyright holder, what rights do they have?
Holding the rights to your work essentially allows you to control distribution channels. That means that you can make decisions about how to reproduce the work, whether to create derivative works, how to share works, and whether a work can be displayed. Later in this session, I'll be talking more about what you can do as an author to retain as many distribution rights as possible.
I'm relieved to hear I have some options. I'm looking forward to hearing more. But first, can you tell me a bit more about how copyright relates to using items in non-traditional formats? Like, what electronic formats does copyright cover?
Sure. Copyright covers information in a number of electronic formats that you might think. This includes email, listserv postings, web pages, and others.
Another question I had related to the length of copyright. How long does copyright last?
Like many complex laws, copyright has evolved over time. The length of copyright is largely dependent on when an item was created. For current materials, copyright generally lasts the life of an author plus 70 years. This includes items dating back to 1977. For items published between 1964 and 1977, copyright lasts 95 years from the date of publication. And for items published between 1923 and 1963, copyright lasts 28 years from the date of publication, with the exception of copyright renewal. The good news is that all items published before 1923 are in the public domain, although other rules apply to items without a copyright notice.
Wow, that's complicated. Are there any exceptions to copyright?
Yes, there are definitely some exceptions that you should know about. The biggest exception to copyright is for items in the public domain. As we already mentioned, this might include works where copyright has expired, such as items published before 1923. Public domain also includes works created by the U.S. government employees working in their official capacity, although there are exceptions for contract work. There are also fair use and classroom use exceptions to copyright, which pertain to things like making copies for class and placing items on print or electronic reserves.
I'm happy to hear that there are exceptions to copyright, especially in regards to using materials for educational use. But what questions should I also consider if I would like to reuse copyrighted material in my own publication?
There are three major questions you should consider when deciding whether to use copyrighted material in your own research. You should consider the types of materials that require permissions for reuse. You should also consider how to secure permissions for reuse and what to do in the event that you are not able to secure permissions.
Are there materials where I don't need to clear rights?
Yes. You don't need to clear rights if something is in the public domain or for most government documents. Also, if a Creative Commons license permitting reuse for educational purposes has been applied, you can often reuse content. Creative Commons licenses are becoming more widespread, which is a great thing for research distribution. Lastly, there are also fair use scenarios where you don't need to clear use.
What is fair use?
Fair use relates to exceptions, often related to scholarly work, in copyright. There are four factors that you need to consider in regards to fair use: the purpose of using a work, the nature of the copyrighted work, the amount used, and the effect of use on the potential market. You'll even want to keep fair use in mind when you're considering the reuse of your own work.
So what should I do if I need to secure rights for reuse?
There's a service called RightsLink from the Copyright Clearance Center at copyright.com, which can help you clear rights. If you cannot find information on clearing rights there, you should attempt to contact the rights holder directly, which is often the publisher. This can be a challenging process, so be sure to document all attempts that you make to locate the rights holder. You should be aware that there is often a fee associated with clearing rights, and that clearing rights can take considerable time. Therefore, always plan ahead and allow plenty of time.
The concept of clearing rights still seems pretty vague to me. What should I ask for?
In order to expedite the process, you'll want to supply a full citation for the material that you're hoping to reuse. You'll also want to describe the nature of use, educational or commercial, the form of distribution, print or electronic, and the number of copies, if applicable. Cambridge University Press has a sample permissions request that can be helpful as a model.
Does that mean that someone can deny a request to reuse something? What do I do if I can't secure permission for reuse?
Unfortunately, in some cases you are either unable to locate the rights holder or the cost of securing rights is prohibitive. If you're unable to find the rights holder, the item may be what's considered an orphan work. If you decide to utilize an orphan work, be advised that the rights of the copyright holder still apply. Basically, this means you're still liable if a rights holder ever comes forward. Therefore, document all attempts to contact the rights holder in order to demonstrate due diligence. Also, you may discover that there are times when the cost of use proves to be prohibitive. In this case, always attempt to negotiate with the rights holder. If that fails, reach out to a librarian and try to locate an alternate source.
I've never even worked with a publisher before. What do I need to know?
There are a number of things you should know when working with a publisher. As I mentioned earlier, one of the most important things to remember is that most publishers require you to sign an agreement with the publisher as a condition of publication. Most are exclusive agreements that make the publisher the rights holder of your publication. That means you are limited in the ways that you can share your own work.
That sounds, limiting. How can I share my research under an exclusive distribution license?
Exclusive publisher agreements generally limit you to making a single copy for personal use, making physical copies for student use in the classroom, and requesting that a print or electronic copy can be put on library reserves. One important thing to know is that student copies should always carry a copyright notice.
Whoa. Is there anything that I can do to make the publisher agreement less restrictive?
Yes, the good news is that there are a number of rights you can ask for your publisher to license back to you. For example, you can ask for the right to post some version of your work on your own website. You can also ask for the right to archive a version of your work in an institutional repository. The Himmelfarb Library has an institutional repository called Health Sciences Research Commons, which I oversee, and I'm happy to help you archive a version of your publication there. You can also license back the rights to share your work more broadly with colleagues or to reuse charts, graphs, figures, and illustrations in presentations or other works. I also wanted to mention the SPARC author addendum. SPARC stands for the Scholarly Publishing and Academic Resources Coalition. On the website sparkopen.org, they have a one-page addendum that can be used to modify the copyright transfer agreement with publishers. This addendum covers things such as distributing copies for research and teaching, posting the article on a personal or institutional website, and creating derivative works.
I definitely want to be able to do all of those things with my research. I will be sure to check out the SPARC addendum.
One last thing I wanted to mention in regards to publishing your research was the issue of open access.
Yes, I've heard that term before, but I'm not really clear what it means.
Open access publishing models can be complicated, but essentially an open access publication is publicly available without a fee-based subscription charge. The downside of publishing in an open access format is oftentimes there is a fee called an article processing charge or an APC for authors. In other words, you may end up having to pay to publish in an open access format. That said, publishing in an open access format has some great benefits. Publishing OA gives the author greater control of distribution, and it expands access to research.
We've covered a lot of information today. What are the key points I should remember going forward?
It's useful to remember that copyright was ultimately designed to protect your rights as the creator. It's helpful in the sense that it ensures that you get credit for your work. The downside of copyright law in its current form is that it severely limits distribution channels, which can be an impediment to the progress of scientific knowledge. It creates a hierarchy of informational access, which can be problematic as well. As a researcher and author, it's always useful to consider options that will allow you to distribute your research widely. And since you're busy, a librarian is always happy to help you explore your options. Before we finish today, I want to quickly run through two scenarios that you might face. In the first case, let's say you're a professor and you want to utilize some graphs from a prior publication in your new research. Is this okay?
Isn't this a case where fair use would apply?
Not necessarily. In this scenario, it's generally advisable to secure permissions through the original publisher. I know you work hard to collect your data. Do you think it's subject to copyright protection?
I should hope so. It takes hours to collect that information. I've heard it can take more time than even putting a publication together.
Theoretically, that makes sense, but copyright protection actually does not extend to raw data. Simply working hard to collect data does not ensure that it's protected by copyright. Also, always remember that oftentimes the PI is the steward of the data, but the university or company that you work for is ultimately the owner. In contrast, an arrangement of data such as a database can be subject to some copyright protection. although once again, the data itself is not subject to copyright protection.
Thanks, that's helpful to know.
And thank you for asking so many wonderful questions. This concludes our session for today. Thank you for taking the time to listen to Copyright for Authors, a part of the Get Yourself Published, Promote Your Research webinar series from the Himmelfarb Library at the George Washington University. If you enjoyed this webinar, please explore other sessions in our series. Also, if you have the time and are able to complete our exit survey, we'd appreciate your feedback. For more information about some of the resources discussed today, feel free to check out resources at the links listed here. If you have any questions about the material covered in this session, or have questions specific to your own research, don't hesitate to contact us at shoover@gwu.edu. On behalf of the Himmelfarb Library Scholarly Communications team, thank you for listening.